Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak with Dr. Julie Gerberding, former director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and now an executive vice president of the pharmaceutical company Merck. We speak about her perspective on the pandemic, how Merck is working to keep its operations moving forward, and the looming threat of bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics. Let's listen. Dr. Gerberding, thank you so much for joining us on the podcast. You were the CDC director from 2002 to 2009, which was a period that included the SARS outbreak. And you did a great deal at both the national and global level to call attention to global health security. So I just wanted to start with a general question. What do you think as you think about the COVID-19 pandemic?
Well, when I look back on the 2003 SARS outbreak, what I realize in retrospect is that we did not create an antiviral treatment or a vaccine that crossed the finish line. And here we are 17 years later, and we would have been in much better shape if those products had actually crossed the finish line in the ensuing years. So I think when we think about global health security and preparedness, we've learned a lot of lessons, not just from SARS, but from the influenza outbreak in 2009, Zika, West Nile, Ebola, et cetera. I think we've learned that this world is going to be full of emerging infectious diseases, and there are some outbreaks that are going to exceed our planning threshold. And so we need to scale up and out our ability to be ready for more and more serious threats. We were prepared for an influenza pandemic. We exercised aggressively, sometimes full-scale three-day exercises with state and local communities. We even practiced with the support of American Airlines to bring a large aircraft into Miami International Airport with pretend passengers and practice quarantining them in 2008. But once a different set of threats became evident, that exercise kind of went to the back of people's minds and our system concentrated on other issues. So we have learned our lesson to cross the finish line with products, with preparedness, and I think with the appropriate protection, countermeasures, and supplies that we need to really make sure that if we get another pandemic, we're ready.
Those are all great points. I wonder, as you look at the response that we've had in the United States, what do you see as sort of the high points or the areas that need improvement?
Well, there are a couple of really remarkable features of this response. One is that compared to the 2003 SARS outbreak, for example, we have multiple shots on goal for antivirals, for immunologic treatments, and for vaccines in just a few months of the onset or recognition of the pandemic. So I think we're so much further ahead. Science will be our solution, and some of these are eventually going to cross the finish line. So that is a very strong indicator of the ability for us over the arc of the pandemic to help bring it under control with medicines and vaccines. I think the second thing we're seeing is just unprecedented collaboration, private-public collaboration, pharmaceutical industry, academia, governments, philanthropists, all coming together to say, we'll help. No one is thinking about profit. No one is thinking about how many publications they get. Everyone is thinking about, we've got to solve this problem. What can we contribute? And how can we partner and be helpful in the bigger picture that's in front of us? I think where we haven't had as much success on a global basis, on a federal basis in the U.S., and even at a community basis, is that we have not had a consistent and thematic framework for making decisions. And that's hard because this pandemic is highly variable across jurisdictions. So of course, one size is not going to fit all. But I do think that right now, especially across the United States, Americans are confused. They're hearing one thing from their governor, but the governor one state over is saying another thing.
Right. Or their mayor is saying something different altogether.
Yeah, they're saying something different. We're just not really getting either consistent messages or explaining why there is so much variability in local response. And that's a very hard thing to sort out in this day of instantaneous communication.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that a lot. The CDC, I think during your tenure, did some terrific work putting out guidance on how to do public health communication well. And on some days, it's hard to know whether people are familiar with that guidance. But it's certainly very important for people to know what to do in their own lives, to hear good, consistent messages.
You know, I just want to say, I do think that the federal communication and certainly the public health communication is important. But if you study the science of what kind of communication people trust, the single most important resource for people is at a community level and usually their own doctor. So part of the secret to having trustworthy communication is to make sure that it gets to the people that individual patients or members of the community are most in touch with. So the local public health officer or someone who can get on the local radio show or the podcast and really put the information into that local context. That's where trust is really generated. The other source of really credible information these days is usually the employer. We're taking that very seriously at Merck. We recognize that we have 65,000 people spread around the world. And if we can provide the best science and help explain our pandemic priorities, that cascades not just into our employees, but to their families and hopefully into their communities so that we can be a force of science and exemplars of how a responsible organization can respond to the epidemic.
That's a great point. It's certainly also true for us at Johns Hopkins. Let me ask you a little bit more about your role at Merck. You are one of the leaders of a huge company which makes many products that so many people around the world depend on. How has the coronavirus affected the company's work?
You know, we very early on established our emergency operations response group, and we set three critical pandemic priorities. Number one, the safety and well-being of our employees and our families, because we absolutely have to make that our top priority. Number two, sustaining the supply of our existing medicines and vaccines to the patients around the world who depend on them. And that includes the patients who are enrolled in our clinical trials. Some of them have cancer, some of them have many other serious conditions. So we have to make sure that we're not just providing them with the medicines that they need, but that we're monitoring their safety and doing all the things we need to assure their safety and well-being. And then lastly, our science. Merck is a leader in infectious diseases and certainly a leader in antivirals and vaccines. So we recognize we have a responsibility to bring our best scientific perspectives to collaborate in finding solutions here. So early on, although most of our office-based workers have been working from home around the world, we have brought our manufacturing people have been heroically working through this entire pandemic, but we're bringing our lab scientists back to the labs and concentrating on the coronavirus work as one of our top priorities. So we want to be part of the solution, both through our own research and development, but also, of course, through the partnerships. And I should also add, through our philanthropy and our volunteerism. We have Merck employees who've been volunteering at Johns Hopkins, for example, because we, along with Pfizer and Lilly, established a mechanism so that our medical doctors and nurses and lab people could volunteer in hospital settings where there was a great demand for help, and we would still pay their full salaries and allow them to contribute their hours of professional time for as long as was necessary.
Got it. That sounds like a real sense of mission at the moment.
Well, people sometimes are surprised to know that the employees in pharmaceutical companies are very purpose-driven. They care deeply about patients and getting medicines and vaccines to people who need them. And I say that not just from a standpoint of, you know, a market perspective in the United States or the developed countries, but really in the context of people around the world.
Well, I appreciate hearing that. And I think that there will be a lot of people who are depending on the research that's done in companies as well as in academic institutions to find a way for the world to get through this pandemic. I wanted to turn to another topic that is related to the response to COVID, which is antimicrobial resistance. This is something that I know you've worked on for many, many years and is a particular priority now for Merck and for other people concerned about the rise of resistant bugs. Why is that connected to the coronavirus?
Now, we've been struggling around the world with the emergence of these so-called super bugs that are highly resistant to the most common and important antibiotics that we have traditionally used to combat them. But what has happened in the context of COVID is we've created almost a perfect storm, where we have very ill patients with underlying vulnerabilities in hospitals for long periods of time, on ventilators, or certainly getting medicines through catheters and other devices that create portals for bacteria to enter the body. And so we've created an environment where they're in institutions that already have a background risk of superbug infection. And then we introduce all of the risk factors for infection with these bacteria. So right now, the best estimates are that about 1 in 7 patients hospitalized with COVID-19 are ending up with a superbug infection of some sort. And about 50% of the people who die from COVID in hospitals actually are dying because of their bacterial superinfections, not really because of the underlying virus per se. Obviously, if they didn't have the virus, they wouldn't be in the hospital and have the superinfection. But it just shows you that this is kind of a hidden force of morbidity and mortality. And in addition to the sort of infection risk, many COVID patients are being treated with broad spectrum antibiotics, and that, of course, just drives more resistance. So we have this perfect storm. My biggest fear, in addition to just the risk, is that we have many patients in hospitals now that don't have the most advanced antibiotics on the formulary, because in the United States, at least, our reimbursement system doesn't allow hospitals to have the resources to pay for those antibiotics. So we do know of examples where people have a superbug infection, but they don't have the right drugs available to treat it. So that's even a greater tragedy.
Got it. So I want to piece through a couple of those questions really quickly. So the first issue is that because we have so many sick patients and they are getting infections in the hospital that may be resistant to medications, this is creating essentially more of a risk for antimicrobial resistance. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, exactly right. These are the patients that are very vulnerable to these super infections with super bugs. And they are the least able to fight them back because they're already so ill.
And the number of drugs to treat those patients is relatively limited in right now. Would that be fair to say too?
Well, what has happened through the years is that companies have stopped working on developing antibiotics because there isn't a reimbursement system. Before we recognized the importance of superbugs, we used to use antibiotics too generously. So companies could make back their investment in the research and development by having a high volume of use. But now we know that that's the wrong thing to do. We need to use these drugs like they were precious orphan drugs only when they're necessary to save a life or treat a very complicated infection. But there's no reimbursement sufficient to pay back what it costs to develop them. So most companies have just abandoned the prospect. In fact, last year, 3 small biotech companies went out of business or went under because they could not bring their innovation to the market successfully. Now, Merck is one of the companies that still has a pipeline in this regard, but it's a hard slog. And we're worried that, you know, if we don't find a way to improve the overall reimbursement scheme for these antibiotics. We won't have them when we need them in a situation like a pandemic that we're currently experiencing.
Right. In other words, it's a type of a market failure. Ordinarily, companies make back their investment and sometimes much more because a lot of people use the medicines. But here you're talking about medicines that you want very few people to use in order to preserve their effectiveness.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
And so part of the issue is this particular crisis, you know, kind of brings that into sharp relief. And we could be at a point in the not so distant future where the infections that people get in the hospital might actually be as deadly or more deadly than the coronavirus itself. Is that a real fear, do you think?
But I think we're already seeing that. As I said, about half of the deaths for patients hospitalized with COVID-19 are attributable to their bacterial superinfections. That in of itself isn't so unusual. Even back in 1918 in influenza, many of the deaths in the influenza pandemic were related to bacterial infections on top of the influenza virus per se. But I think here we're having the additional complication of these are really hard to treat and we don't have the right antibiotics to do the job quickly.
And so part of the solution there is fixing the market failure. Part is probably additional scientific work to find those other antibiotics. And you also mentioned that there are some specific reimbursement issues even now that may be limiting access for patients.
Yeah, there are a number of longer-term policy and regulatory issues that need to be addressed. But in the short run, it's also extremely important in the healthcare environment, of course, that health workers are using the best possible infection control precautions so that these organisms don't spread. And I think when you look at the pictures of health workers who are taking care of COVID patients, they are dressed from stem to stern in personal protective equipment. So that is important. That can help. But we also have to be really mindful not to overutilize the antibiotics in these very sick patients. And of course, if someone's on a ventilator and they get a fever, you don't really always know what's going on. So it's tempting to just say, well, it might be bacterial. Let's give them a strong antibiotic just in case, because it could save their life if that really was the problem. But when you add that up over a hospital or a community full of patients, it's an awful lot of antibiotics that are being used that probably aren't necessary. And the result of that is even more drug resistance.
Well, it sounds like out there are some policy solutions that really aren't based on kind of specific fee-for-service reimbursement for antimicrobial drugs that address resistance that support the ability of companies to make them, but don't make the reimbursement dependent on the number of people who use them. Would that be a reasonable principle?
Yeah, I think what we've got to figure out is how do we create an incentive for small and large companies to continue to do the basic science and at the same time avoid the temptation to market these antibiotics inappropriately or to encourage their overuse. And there are some suggested policy solutions that we've been working on, but unfortunately, they haven't received much traction. And we're kind of left in a situation now where hardly anyone is in the business of trying to create new and innovative antibiotics. Maybe that will change after the pandemic, but right now, I think we're really in a tenuous situation.
In a way, going back to where we started with this conversation, it sort of is similar to why the treatments for SARS never really made it all the way through. There was no real clear market at that point once SARS had gone away. And kind of what you're saying is that for antimicrobial resistance, we don't want that same situation. We don't want it to be that it's just very difficult for people to invest in finding new antimicrobials and bringing them to market because they think they won't be able to, you know, recoup their investment.
Well, I think that's well said. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, really appreciate hearing your perspective on the coronavirus in general and these very specific issues. And thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you. Thanks for your interest.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.